There were some dads that got thrown under the bus there, I think. the kids made a video for Mother's Day, so they wanted to make one for Father's Day as well. And so there you go. There's some kids just being a little maybe too honest about their dads. That's great. All right, so you got your Bibles open to Ephesians chapter 6. We're going to be in the same passage for this entire series. We'll focus on one particular verse today. John Maxwell is famous for this particular quote. He says, "You teach what you know, but you reproduce who you are." And that scares me a little bit, if I'm being honest with you. It scares me because I love to learn, all right? I love to teach. I love to acquire knowledge so that I can then sound like I'm intelligent or sound like I have a clue about what is going on in the world. So I like to absorb and consume information and then put that information out. And I do that a lot with my children. I've done that as my son has fallen in love with Legos, or my son has chosen basketball. I don't know anything about basketball. I will gather information and I will consume as much as I can, and then I spew it out on them to try to be all intelligent and special, and it doesn't ever work exactly like I want it to, because the reality is, as much as I say and as much as I teach, they're ultimately going to copy what I do. Right? They're going to copy who I am. And that's why John Maxwell says that we can teach what we know, but we reproduce who we are. These people are going to follow our example. And I see it in my kids. And sometimes it breaks my heart because I see how they respond to each other when they're mad or in a fight. And I know that they learned that from me in some way. I've seen how they respond to their mother, and it drives me nuts. Like, and I know that in some way, at some level, at some time, they have seen me lose my patience. They've seen me lose my cool, or they've seen me act in that way, and they think that it's appropriate because I've done it. And then I have to try to go back and recreate it and teach them how it's not supposed to be that way. It's supposed to be different. You're supposed to show honor. And then they're all confused. You get that look on their face like, yeah, but you did it. And like, oh, well, I know, but I wasn't supposed to do it, right? You ever been there, right? It's just me. I'm the only one that has this problem. Okay, that's my family. And it breaks my heart because I know that I can do a better job. I know that there's so much more that I could be doing. There's so many things that I could be better at, things that I could focus more on. And I say all that to say this. So everything that I teach, everything that we talk about, every message that I give, it's kind of an overflow of what I'm reading, what I'm studying, what God is showing me, okay? And as I prepare for this, I'm just telling you, like, this might be the most personally convicting message for me, right? As I'm writing this, I'm reading this, as I'm preparing, like, the message, I'm saying, okay, this is what I'm learning. Like, it's breaking me, right? I'm, like, crushed the weight of the lessons that I personally have learned through this. So we need to kind of respond to God's love together here, all right? Because this is, even though I'm saying it to myself, I'm learning this, and it's important for me to get this stuff. It's important for me to recognize the weaknesses that I have, the strengths that I can continue to work on, other things, other holes, and so I've learned an enormous amount about myself just reading this and evaluating and thinking about just examples to talk about or preparing this message, and I just needed to get that out there. I just needed to get it out there. Here's the point for today. Here's the point. This is what I've come to grips with, right? A child's inclination follows a dad's demonstration. A child's inclination follows a dad's demonstration. I know there's some people that's like, yeah, but there's not, what if there's not a father in the home? I mean, can't you raise a child without a father in the home? Sure, but there is a natural order of things. There's a biblical model. And so we're talking about that specifically. And we're talking about the role the male plays in the home. And so even though there are possibilities of scenarios where children can be raised and turn out fine. The best case scenario is a home with a father and a mother. You guys know this. And that the father is the leader in the home. The father is being the role model, is setting the tone and the example. And as they demonstrate what they do, you're going to see the family sort of take that same tone. Though the child's inclination follows the dad's demonstration. And I want to read this verse. We're going to read this passage again, and we're going to focus on verse 4. We pushed this back a week, and so all this kind of got mixed up. So we were going to go in order, but we're going to skip to verse 4 because it's Father's Day, and so we're going to talk to dads. We're going to talk to all the fathers. So here we go. Let's start in verse 1 of chapter 6 in Ephesians. And then we'll focus on verse 4. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you and that you may live long in the land. Verse 4, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Now, the focus of this entire series, Future Proof Family, is to talk about what we can do as parents, what we can do as Christ followers, even people who aren't parents yet, future parents, people who have been parents, what can we do for their kids, your point, that all of it wrapped in just a few verses, just an enormous amount. So we're going to look at verse 4. I want to pull out three truths this morning, three truths that fall in line with a child's inclination follows dad's demonstration. In that fourth verse, and it starts with fathers, and we talked about this last week just a little bit. The first two talk about children obeying your parents, honor your father and mother. It looks like they're verses for children. We're going to see over the next couple weeks how they really are for the parents. And in this last passage, fathers, do not provoke your children, it's speaking directly to men. Now, here's what you need to get before we go any further. This verse and this passage is connected to what Paul just talked about in chapter 5. It's wrapped up with a nice bow in the last phrase of the verse, of the Lord. So there's a very clear picture Paul wants to give of what you're supposed to be, of who you're supposed to follow, of what example has been set for us, and that is the Lord's. And so even though it doesn't say, fathers, do not provoke your children or your wives, it could be implied, because the actions of the fathers and what the man, the male role model, is supposed to demonstrate, men who aren't fathers, who have been fathers, who are fathers now, who may be fathers soon in the future, it still applies to you. Men, do not provoke your children, your future children, your former children. Like, can you have former children? The children that have grown up and moved on, what do you call them? They're still children. I don't know what to call them. Whatever. Okay, so fathers, do not provoke your children or your family or your spouse. But the reason he's not talking about spouse is because he just did. If you go back to chapter 5, you see that he gives a very short couple verses on wives and how they submit to their husbands. And that submitting to one another out of reverence, so it's a both submitting to each other. And this much longer dissertation on husbands, this passage on husbands and how they really bear the burden of leading their wives, of leading them like Christ leads the church. And so you can take those same principles that he just said to wives and apply it to this verse. So even though we're going to talk about fathers to their kids, because that's what it says, it could easily be applied to your wives. It could easily be applied to your other family members. It could be easily applied to your coworkers, to your friends, to your neighbors, right? How you men who are supposed to set example in your home, set the example in everything that you do. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Now, just for a second, let's focus on of the Lord. Because we know that Jesus has already given us the example of what to do and how to do it. It ties back to the first verse in chapter 1, which begins with therefore, which ties back to everything else he's been talking about. And you have in chapter 5, verse 1, be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. There's the example of Jesus, who is the perfect picture of one who was brought up in the discipline and instruction of the Father, who gave us this perfect example to follow, who tells us over and over again as you read the Gospels to love the Father, to honor the Father, to pray to the Father, to worship the Father, to glorify the Father, to follow the Father. So we have this example in Jesus. And the key here and of the Lord is to follow that example so that our children are always pointed not to us and what we're doing and what we're accomplishing, but always back to who we are doing it for. God, the creator, right? The ruler, the one triumphant over death, the savior, the provider, the protector, sustainer, redeemer, healer, helper, the one and only true God. Everything we do should point back to him. Of the Lord is that bow, is that the package that makes it all make sense. It's not just my discipline. It's not just my instruction. It is discipline instruction that's already been shown to me. It's discipline instruction that has already been given as an example through Jesus that I now should follow. For my children's sake, for my wife's sake, for my family's sake, for everyone around me's sake, the men would be men. So what does it look like for a man to be a man? What does it look like for the father to be a leader in his home? If a child's inclination follows dad's demonstration, what does dad need to demonstrate? Well, the first thing you'll see is that dad needs to demonstrate love. There are three commands. The first one, it starts with a negative phrase, and the second two, bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. So bring them up in discipline, bring them up in instruction. The bow is of the Lord. So the first command is negative. Do not provoke your children to anger. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. This might just be me in my house, but when I first read that, I'm like, how do I discipline my kids and not provoke them to anger? How do I tell my kids what they're supposed to do and them not get mad at me? Anybody else have that problem? Anyway, there's a couple nodding hands. All right. I appreciate that. So for me, it's like, all right, we've watched enough TV. We're turning the TV off. Now all of a sudden, there's anger in my house. Or at least that's what it feels like. They've all bowed up against me. And I'm like, oh, man, I provoked anger. I'm not supposed to do that, right? Okay, TV's back on. Like, no, that can't be right. That can't be how this works, right? That can't be how this works. So you dig a little deeper, and you see that the word provoke, actually, if you look at it, in the translation I'm reading, the ESV, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger. Well, provoke and anger are really the same word. There's really only two words for the whole phrase, provoke your children to anger. The word for provoke, anger, is podragizo. Podragizo, in case you want to write that down. It means to exasperate, to infuriate. It literally means to promote anger from your children, right? It means to in what you do, like purposely make them mad at you and the world. And it even goes deeper than that. Because the anger and what you, well, let me just tie this together. So in Colossians 3:21, Paul uses a very similar phrase. In fact, it gets translated in most translations pretty much the exact same way. Fathers, do not provoke your children lest they become discouraged is usually how it is translated. But the words are different because the word for provoke is eradizo, which means to stir up, okay? And discourage, lest they become discouraged, is one word, which is athumeo, which means broken. So if you tie those two passages together, if you tie, do not provoke your children, right? If you tie that phrase, podragizo, with Paul saying basically the same thing in Colossians 3:21, he's saying, don't break your children. Don't put so much pressure on your children that they lose hope, that they can ever meet your expectations. Don't try to be their God and set such a high standard that they can't ever achieve it and become discouraged and hopeless and just stop trying. They get mad at you, get mad at the world, get mad at God. That's not a demonstration of grace. That's not a demonstration of love. That is not how God has proven his love to us. That is not how God has demonstrated being a father to us. Demonstrate love. When we discipline our kids, we know that sometimes love is patient, love is kind and sweet, but it's tough and just when it needs to be, right? Demonstrating love doesn't mean we give them everything they want. We can't break them to the point to where they don't think they're worth anything, or they don't believe that they can accomplish anything, or they don't believe they'll ever meet the expectations you've set as a parent. It destroys their will. Now, the opposite end of that extreme is that you don't discipline them at all, that your idea of love is to give them whatever they want, when that's not love. It's to just, hey, you know, good luck, and I'll just meet your every need and do whatever you want and be your best friend. That doesn't help, because on one end, they don't know what love is because they've never seen love demonstrated by you. On the other end, they don't know what love is. They have no respect for you because they don't know what honor and respect has never been demonstrated to them. So to demonstrate love, to not provoke your children to anger, is to show the same kind of love that's been shown to you, to demonstrate the same kind of grace and patience and forgiveness. This is what it is. Do not provoke your kids to anger. Is you, fathers, when you're getting mad because they drew on the wall or they broke something that was important to you or they any number of the many things I have, that my son likes to take sharp objects and see what it does to plastic. And so just about anything plastic in my house, like our little stereo receiver and television sets, have scratch marks in them because he likes to take sharp objects and see what it does to plastic, okay? All right, these things happen in my house. When those moments happen and your kids do something that even when they know they're not supposed to do it, like you have to ask yourself, okay, there is room for discipline here. There is room to teach, to speak to them the truth they need to know about what they should and should not do. But how much patience does God have for me for all the mistakes I make? How much forgiveness has God shown me? How much has God done for me when I've done so little in return for him? We have to stop and remember what has already been demonstrated for us and then respond in that way. It just should cause us to pause. But if we know our children's inclination is to follow our demonstration, then dads, men, then we must demonstrate the love that's been demonstrated to us. We must prove to them the love that's been proven to us. We must give them a reason to follow us, just as God has given us every reason to follow him. So demonstrate love. That's the first thing. Do not provoke your children to anger, right? Demonstrate love. The second one, bring them up in the discipline of the Lord. So here is an opportunity to demonstrate leadership. Now, the word there for discipline is paideia, which is the same word used in 2 Timothy 3:16, which all scripture is breathed out by God. It's profitable for reproof, for teaching, for training in righteousness. The word training is the same word, paideia. And so the discipline here is a training. It is a teaching. It is speaking of the right direction. Now, when I thought about this, I think about what would it, well, let me just ask you this question. What would it be like? How many of you guys have ever played sports? Ever been on a team where there was a coach or something like that? Okay, a lot of you. All right. For those of you who haven't, let's just imagine for a second. All right. I was a theater nerd. So, all right. I can use my example too. Anytime there was someone coaching you or helping you, if they only told you what not to do, how effective of a method of teaching is that? If my son goes to shoot a basketball and he shoots poorly and all the coach says is, that's a horrible shot, don't do it that way. How much does that help him? Well, how should I shoot it? Not that way. It's not very effective, right? If I'm on stage acting and I say a line wrong and the director wants to say it and all she says or all he says is no, that's bad. Say it again. No, and I never get it right because I never know how to say it. I never know what to do. Like I'm just trying to figure it out on my own. That's not training. That's judgment. That's ridicule, right? That's not helping me. And this discipline, which gets tied to the rod of the shepherd, is not there to hurt. It's there to guide. It's there to keep the sheep on path, right? The rod is there to to protect and to keep them on the path. And so that same word here for discipline, used again by Paul for training and righteousness when he speaks to Timothy, we know that what he's talking about is this opportunity for us men to be leaders, to demonstrate leadership, to lead them properly, to train them properly, to show them what they should do, right? Training is, it's less about what they shouldn't do, and it's more about what they should do. So we get to tell them what they should do. We get to point them in the right direction. And it ought to be grounded in Scripture. And I know I say it all the time, but you ought to know what to tell your kids because you know what God has already said you should do. It's what he tells us. I can read some verses to you. Here's some verses. Whatever you do, do with all you've got. It's Colossians 3:23. Love not in word or talk, but in deed and truth. 1 John 1:17. Speak the truth in love. Ephesians 4:15. Stand firm in the faith. Act like men. Be strong. 1 Corinthians 6:13. Be strong and courageous. Deuteronomy 31:6. Whoever lacks in integrity walks. I'm sorry. Whoever walks in integrity walks securely. Proverbs 10:9. Forgive as Christ has forgiven you. Ephesians 4:32. Do all to the glory of God, 1 Corinthians 10:31. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, Proverbs 3:5. I mean, you could go on and on and on. Throughout this whole Bible, there are all these lessons on trust and honor and courage and wisdom and faith and love and grace. It's all here. So as you teach your children what they should do, you have to know what they're supposed to do. You should know what you should be doing. And you have this opportunity to bring them up in discipline of the Lord, the example that he has already set. And there is a very specific example. I'm just going to give you something because we should have something, just to, maybe a good place to start. And Jesus gives us in the Sermon on the Mount a very simple three-step, I don't know how to describe. He basically says, here are three things you should do, three disciplines you should do. And if we're looking for of the many things that we should do, here's three. I'm going to give you three. This is from Matthew chapter 6. And Jesus talks about prayer. He talks about giving. He talks about fasting. And so I'm going to give you just these three to see where you are, just to evaluate on these three things that Jesus himself said we should do as he was training his disciples and training the thousands of others listening to him on the Sermon on the Mount. Here's what he said we should do. Prayer. To pray. He gives us the example of prayer. We talked about that in the last series. Now, do your children know how to pray? Do they know the power of prayer? Do they know what they can pray for? Have they learned how to pray from how you pray? My mom last week lost an earring in this giant pool. And this beautiful story, I didn't ask her permission if I could share the story, but I'm going to share it anyway. She lost this earring that she's had for, how long have you had it? Who knows? Long time. Okay. Years and years, right? And she had this little earring, and she was just sad. She was devastated. They looked all over for it. She thought maybe it had fallen in her bathing suit somewhere. And so she had all the little grandkids. She brought all the grandkids and said, listen, I really, really don't want to lose this earring. Let's say a prayer. And so all the kids prayed that she would find her earring. And they couldn't find it in the pool, and they couldn't find it. She went to the dressing room, she couldn't find it. And a little bit later, they were back in the room, and she was changing, and she heard this little clink in the bathroom floor, and there was the earring. Now, she had already checked, but wherever it was, there it was. She had found it. And so she goes back to the kids, and she's like, look, look. Now, for her, she's crazy excited. She's like, we prayed. Look what this is. It's awesome. This is awesome. I found the ring. And the kids are like, yeah, we prayed. God answered prayer. What's the big deal? All right? That's awesome. Yeah. Do your kids know that they can pray to God like that? Do your kids know because they've seen you pray, because you take time to stop and pray for specific things, for specific people, for specific purpose and reasons? Jesus tells us and gives us an exact, he tells us how to pray. We just talked about that in the last series. We know we're supposed to pray. We talked about how to pray, what to pray for. Do your kids get that from you? Is the only example of prayer they have is what you pray before they sleep, or what you pray before you eat, or maybe what they might hear on Sunday morning? If prayer is one of the three disciplines that Jesus specifically gives us, shouldn't your kids learn how to pray deeper from you? Because you pray deeper, you pray more often. Giving is another one. Do your children know how to share? We have a problem with sharing in my house. Do they know how to give with a generous heart? Do they know what a tithe is? When Jesus talks about giving and giving cheerfully and generously, your kids will see you give and help others. They will see you give and support a family, friends, or the church. They will see you respond in that way, or they will see you not. Now, this particular, we talk about this in our house, but this is one particular area that I got real convicted, because we give an allowance to our kids, and we have them, they tithe, they're supposed to tithe off of it, but we're all digital or whatever, and they have their own bank accounts, and so we just transfer their allowance, like, from one account to the other, so we don't actually ever give them, like, cash in their hands, which is so lazy, it's so awful. And here's what's happened. The problem with that is, because I don't, like, put a dollar in their hand and say, all right, now, what are you going to give back to God? And I actually have that lesson and talk to them about it. They forget about it. They forget about what it looks like. And every time they get so self-absorbed about what they want and what they think they should have. And we don't even have TV to watch a lot of TVs where they don't see commercials, so they're always looking for stuff. But when we did, they were like, I want that, and I need that, and I want that. And we got to change, like, how our kids think about stuff and material things. Because if we're not teaching them what it looks like to be generous, if we're not teaching that to them, the world is going to teach them that that's irrelevant. It's supposed to be about you. It's supposed to be about what you want. It's supposed to be about what you think you should have. Giving is one of the three main disciplines that Jesus talked about. And your kids will learn how to give and be generous from you. How generous are you? How much are you giving? Fasting is another one. And fasting is like one of those weird ones where people are like, oh, how do you fast? I don't really fast. Stop eating for 7 days? What does that work? How do you do that? And we should probably talk about that in more detail at another time. But in general, fasting is just you just taking a break from something. It's stopping something that is becoming more important in your life than God is. It's something that is distracting you from your worship of God. It's something that you can remove, and then as you think about it, because you've become accustomed to it, of wanting it, you remove it, and when you desire it, you remind yourself that I need to desire God more. And that's, you know, in a nutshell, really what fasting is supposed to be. It's removing something. It's resting from something. It's taking something out, a distraction out, so that you can focus more on God. And when you read through the scriptures and you see that fasting was a major part of spiritual growth, of the spiritual life. And fathers, I mean, we take breaks from different things, but not as seriously as we should. This is another one that hit me really home. Like, when was the last time we just took a break from technology? Like, me and the families, like, we don't need this. Let's just take a break from it and just fast from it for a week. Oh, my world will fall apart. I gotta get an email. When was the last time that you just decided to take a break from a certain type of food, or take a break from, any number of things? To stop and not just for you, but as a family, right? Men, as a family, to stop and then come together as a family and say, hey, you know, this is normally when we would sit down and watch TV, but instead we're going to open the Bible and read it. Hey, this is normally when we would, you know, go and do this, but we're going to stop and we're just going to pray together. Fasting is a phenomenal exercise. It's one of the three disciplines that Jesus gives us. And it should point back to that male men to lead this in your home, to lead some type of fasting, to lead giving, right? To lead a prayer. Don't rely on your wife to do it. Don't think that that's supposed to be her duty. You are supposed to be responsible for the spiritual growth and development of your home. You are supposed to be the leader, which means that you are supposed to lead. It's on me. It's on you. Lead your home. Demonstrate leadership. Here's the third one. So we have, do not provoke your children, right? Demonstrate love. Bring them up in the discipline of the Lord. Demonstrate leadership. Bring them up in the instruction of the Lord. Demonstrate lessons. Because here's the truth. Here's the reality. As much as we men it might be easier for us to speak it, to teach it, to say it. Let's do this. Let's fast here. Let's lead, or to take those opportunities for leadership. We are going to have times where we fail. We are going to have times where we lose our patience with our kids, with our spouse. We're going to have times when we make a mistake. And those are teachable moments. They're teachable moments because we have been taught how to properly respond. And a real man is going to recognize it and is going to teach his kids the proper way to respond. I messed up. I got mad at you. I lost my temper. And the Bible says to be slow to anger. Quick to listen, slow to speak. And I did not do that. And I'm sorry. Do you forgive me? The power of your demonstrating these lessons to them teaches them how they're supposed to respond when they make mistakes. How do they see you forgive people? How do they see you love others? Men, how do they see you love your spouse? You demonstrate these lessons, and this is how your kids, this is my kids, like how I respond in my house, I know is ultimately how my kids are going to respond when they're a husband and a father. So how I treat my wife is how they're learning how to treat their wife. How I respect women is how they will respect women. You have an opportunity, men, to lead your kids to maybe not make the same mistakes you did, to be the kind of leader that you want them, that you believe that they can be, that you know that God has purposed them to be. But a child's inclination is to follow dad's demonstration. And if you're not demonstrating it, the result might be that they are exactly who you are. And they're exactly what you demonstrated, and it's exactly what you don't want them to be. You guys know there was a travesty, horrible, heartbreaking story from Charleston, South Carolina. And I read that Dylan Roof was not raised a racist. He was not raised violent. But something about an incident that happened a year or so ago, he said, quote, awakened him. And it changed his perspective on the world. And it led him to make the decision that he made, a very thought out, horrible decision that none of us would want our kids to do, right? I read the response from his parents, and it's heartbreaking because they're heartbroken, as I would be. And I watched the video of the relatives or the spokespeople, and you probably saw this, as they stood in the bond hearing and said, I'm so hurt, but I forgive you. And I just want you to know that because God loves me and loves me in all my craziness and all my stupidity, I know he loves you too, and so I forgive you. One after another, not all of them did it, but one after another, they stood up and they said, and I heard the story of the son or the nephew that stood up and protected his aunt. I mean, the whole story is just horrible because an attack on one church is an attack on the whole church. It was heartbreaking to read that stuff. And here's what I thought about. I don't know his parents. I don't know how they raised him. I don't know the details, but here's what I do know. If you don't demonstrate love and leadership and the lessons from God's word, if you don't demonstrate Christ to your kids, then they will see the world demonstrate they don't need it, and they'll choose that instead. It's too important to think that our kids are just going to get it somehow on their own by coming an hour on Sunday and hearing a lesson. It's not how it works. And men, you can't expect the spouse to do it because you just don't feel like it. You don't like to read, or it's just not important to you. I'm sorry. But it is a burden that we bear. It is a burden on our shoulders. And if you're neglecting that, you have to live with that. As God has said very clearly, fathers, it's on you. Men, it's on you. I'm heartbroken about the Charleston thing, and I just needed to say something about it today for sure, because I know that a lot of you have been hearing the stories and been praying about it and been praying through it, and we have been praying for the families and of the victims and all the people there. There's a lot of stuff going on. I know that some people get nervous because it was a prayer service at a church. People show up, and he sat there for an hour before he started talking and then just decided to pull a gun out. You should know, all right, just you should know that there we have a security team of people that are watching for that kind of stuff. They're always here. They're always looking. It's not a pleasant way to say it or to talk about it, but I just want you to know that we do everything we can to keep you safe and protect you. We do everything we can to make sure that you can, and your children especially, can come be a part of this church and feel safe and secure. But ultimately, I know that if something like that were to happen here, my prayer is that the life that you've lived, the example you've set for your family, for your friends, for those who know you, see you as one who has demonstrated the love of God, has demonstrated leadership, has demonstrated lessons. And there's no doubt whatsoever about where you'll spend eternity. And there's no doubt whatsoever about your faith and the grace in which you stood. As we talk about the role and responsibility of parents to follow the example of Christ and follow the example of God, I pray that you guys don't let it go in one ear and out the other, but see it and take it seriously and be the example, the leaders to your kids they need you to be. The inclination is to follow your demonstration. So demonstrate your love for God more than anything else. Will you pray with me? Father, we know you are sovereign. And even among the evil and the darkness in this world, we see your light and run to it. Father, may that alone be the motivation to be ones who demonstrate your love, demonstrate leadership, demonstrate the lessons that you have given us in your word. May each and every person here, dads, moms, men, women, all of us, choose to follow you. Choose to trust you. Choose, God, to demonstrate your love. Prove your love at every opportunity. We pray that in Jesus' name, amen.